According to Porter's model of the value chain, there are primary activities and there are secondary activities. The primary activities consist of five activities. These activities are inbound logistics, operations, outbound logistics, marketing and sales, and service. Each of these activities will differ from industry to industry. For example, inbound logistics can consist of receiving goods, inspection, storage, receiving returns. Operations include activities associated with how we transform the inputs, like raw materials and components, into outputs, like new products. Outbound logistics are activities associated with how we will process orders, packaging, shipping, distribution, how we will put the finished product in the hands of our customers. Marketing and sales are activities associated with providing the customer with the information, the messages that they need to know about the products that we are producing, including how excellent they are, how they are different than other products or services in the market. So these activities might include a product distribution channel, pricing, how we will promote, we will employ different selling techniques. Service activities are those activities that ensure the purchased product enhances or preserves value for the customer. And this might include advice, repairs, training, maintenance, warranty. On the other hand, support activities are four activities, according to Porter: procurement, technology development, human resource management, firm infrastructure. Procurement are activities that refer to the function of purchasing, whether physical inputs or services. And these services, support services like procurement, they support all the primary activities. So we might have a procurement department that supports the purchase of raw materials. And raw materials will be used for inbound logistics or manufacturing. Also, in procurement, we have negotiations. So we get the best price and the best inputs. We have the HR activities, and the HR department is responsible to hire the right skills at the right time and make the talent and skills of the hired employees available to different departments. So in primary activities, we have those activities that directly add value in the value chain. Inbound logistics is one of these primary activities. And these inbound logistics refer to the management of supplier relationships relating to parts or components or finished products that are we procure or bring to the organization to produce our products or to deliver our services. Let's have an example. In manufacturing iPads, for example, we will have manufacturing settings that include to scheduling, shipping, inventory management. And this could be for electronic parts and components, for the screen, for the metal components of the device. And also in the primary activities, we have operations. So these are the manufacturing or the change processes that are employed to produce the product. For example, we have the production lines producing certain parts and assembly lines assembling these parts into the actual final product. Then we have outbound logistics. So these are the activities that the business will have to get the finished product to the customer. So we have different distribution channels that make having the product accessible, convenient. We have shipping to distribution centers or stores or retailers. And we have marketing and sales. These are the activities that create awareness in the market for our products or services or our brand. And we focus on the benefit derived from having our products and services. And remember when we talked about value proposition, so how we communicate the benefits of our products and services in a way that makes the customer takes the buying decision and commit to our brand. And we have customer service. And these activities are there to support the customer, whether it's before or during or after they purchase our products or service. For example, we have technical support, we have maintenance, we have repair support, we have warranty, we have installation, we have replacement, we have upgrading, we have customer training. And here, our main objective is to maintain the relationship with our customers so they have the maximum value of our products and services and maintain the highest levels of customer satisfaction. And this will create loyalty and commitment to our brand. And we can apply these primary activities on any business. For example, let's apply it on a bakery. So the main objective of the bakery is transforming ingredients such as flour, sugar, butter, and other ingredients into final products and selling these products to the customers and maintaining the highest profitability of the business. So when we think of inbound logistics, we will find that the bakery receives raw material and we take decisions regarding these materials, the quality of the materials that we obtain, the type of ingredients. For example, we might have organic ingredients. We might buy from local vendors. And then we have operations. So in the bakery, these are the production operations using different tools and different machinery, recipes and bakers to produce these products and also to provide these products to the customers. Then we have outbound logistics. So we track the how the finished products are moving through the value chain and reaching our customers. Are we going to take these products to other stores? Do we have our own stores? Then we have marketing and sales. How we will make our customers know about our products. So we might have advertisement. We might have props leading to our stores. Then we have service. How can we assist our customers in buying our products, whether in store or online? Let's talk now about secondary or support activities. These activities are activities that's not directly involved in the transformation of inputs into outputs or raw materials into products, but they provide underlying support for the primary activities. We have firm infrastructure, we have human resource management, we have technology and procurement. The firm infrastructure is those activities that determine how the firm or the business is organized and managed and led. The effect of leadership on the business. In human resource management, these are the activities that involve in recruiting, training, compensating employees and motivating them. This could be related to designing jobs based on level of skills or knowledge or expertise, how we can attract talent, how we can recruit the best, how we can motivate our employees, how we can assess their performance. And then technology. How we can use different technologies like machinery, devices, computer systems, telecommunication, software. And we use all these technological advancements to support the primary activities. For example, if we need a website to sell our products in the bakery, we might need technologies to process a debit card or to process credit cards, to make orders. And procurement. Our bakery needs procuring, negotiating and purchasing raw materials, machinery, different supplies. And these different items are used by different primary activities. But what is the difference between supply chain and value chain? The supply chain is A system consists of people, activities, information, and resources involved in creating a product and moving it to the customer. It's a broader concept than the value chain. The value chain consists of the activities within one firm, one business, but the supply chain can include entire process of creating and distributing a product, even if this means that we include different businesses in the supply chain. And right now, they are merging these two types of chains together, and we have value supply chains. So we have supply chains that create value. So we don't have a single objective and a metric to assess this value. We might use different metrics to assess this. And we have now the concept of strategic supply chain management. So we assess the speed or the cycle time. We assess the quality. We assess the flexibility of the chain. That's why we have a new emerging concept, although these are not that new, like agility. And at the core of strategic supply chain management, we have adaptability. And adaptability is the willingness of the business and its capacity to reshape the supply chain when we see it's necessary to create a one supply chain for the customer, to minimize costs, and to increase the value. And also, we have alignment. So we have to create consistency within different components in the supply chain. Let's talk about process management in depth. Process management is the design and development of the workflow and the connectivity of the operational requirements, the processes needed to ensure that our business produces products and services that are efficiently and effectively produced and delivered to the customers. In process management, we focus on specific tasks to be accomplished by the organization and orders or sequences in a way that makes the most efficient and effective workflow, and to determine how the transformation process of products and services will be designed. And remember, our aim here is to maximize efficiency. We have a very common example when Henry Ford thought of the assembly line and how the assembly line approach and also introducing automated technology manufacturing process changed how we manufacture products, how we fabricate products. Also, process management includes process standardization. We design and utilize common platforms and create common tasks and sequence those tasks to produce or to develop different products or services. We have also process simplification. We design and utilize the minimum number of tasks and activities to produce the products or provide the service. So we research the process and we innovate an approach to these processes that makes the production or the delivery of the service through the minimum number of steps. Then we have process design, layout, and execution. In this, we assess and implement the tasks necessary to get the required work accomplished. And we group these tasks and sequence these tasks to ensure the most efficient and effective processes are utilized. And during all these approaches, we have to take decisions. So we take decisions regarding how the flow of work will be sequenced, what steps that have to be initiated or included in the process, how we will assess quality, how we will design the timing, how we will manage the performance and expectations. So in process design, layout, and execution, we take the decisions to determine how the flow of work will be sequenced and what steps must be initiated to ensure the quality, timing, performance, and service expectations are met. This could include fabrication, assembly, quality assurance, clerical and administrative support, internal and external transportation, environmental initiatives, hazard waste handling and management. Will we employ flexible or fixed production approaches? And we use different tools. For example, like flow charts, we use PERT charts, we use Gantt charts. PERT charts are charts to show scheduling. And it is a scheduling methodology that focuses on task sequencing and the identification of the critical path that will greatly impact the ability to complete a project or a process, and the length of time needed for completion. Gantt chart is another methodology that we use to schedule the steps associated with a project or a process and the time required to complete each step. So how we design a process? The first step is to define the tasks and activities required. The second one is to identify the sequencing needed to maximize efficiency and effectiveness. Then you create the process layout and you fine-tune this process. And lastly, you execute the process and regularly evaluate the process and take the necessary steps to improve it. Then we have material management. Material management refers to the management of the inputs required to develop the product or the service. And these materials or inputs are related to components for assembly, parts for repair or maintenance, raw materials that's necessary for the manufacturing or the fabrication, how we will dispose and manage hazardous waste, the safe handling of food in food industry businesses, regulation compliance for handling of goods, handling of the finished products. And we have facility design and layout. So as operations managers, we take key decisions in facility design and layout. And these decisions are related to capacity plant, facility, retail locations, warehousing and storage. And facility design and layout is the infrastructure layout and related facility components that will be required to house and support the processes and materials that we are using. We take decisions regarding capacity. What is capacity? It's the maximum amount of products that we can produce, or the maximum amount of service interactions that we can deliver, taking into consideration the constraints that our facility or equipment or process sit upon us. So we have decisions relating to capacity, plant size or the footprint of the facility, the plant layout, how we lay out different departments. And usually these decisions are taken early in the beginning when we are setting up a business based on estimated sales, anticipated market conditions. And of course, there are different approaches. One of the approaches is hub approach. And Walmart and big retailers like Walmart are using the concept of regional hub approach to support different stores and different outlets. So whenever a big retailer is opening a new store, they take into consideration how they will support the inventory, the stocking and restocking of these new stores through its existing distribution system. Or do we need to expand? And also in operations management, we have capital asset evaluation and acquisition. And here we assess the state of our capital assets, and we decide or determine, are these assets are capable of meeting our needs? Do we have the operational capability by using our capital assets available to retain or to invest in, or do we have something missing that we need to acquire? Or do we have something or asset that is no longer necessary and we can sell it off? We also assess our equipment and technology. Do we have obsolete equipment that we cannot use or will affect the quality of our production? Do we need to replace or modernize our existing equipment and production lines? Are our existing capital assets satisfy our needs and future requirements? And then we have supply chain management. And supply chain management refers to the management of the flow of materials or the products or the information and the cost associated with this flow through the front end of the organization value chain. This includes planning, sourcing, and delivering components, parts, or products, and then delivering the finished product to the market, whether we are employing business-to-business strategy or business-to-customer or business-to-government, whether we sell in physical locations or online. That's why we need to develop a responsive network to deal with returns, unsold items, for example. And we include this in our planning and in our operating execution and also in our performance evaluation. And also this will include the supply chain structure and infrastructure. And as an operations manager, you will find yourself taking decisions regarding outsourcing of some steps in your supply chain or some functions. Or you keep certain activities in-house. You also will take decisions regarding the software or the application or the e-commerce applications that you need to have to support your business. You might also use sales forecasts to plan and determine the quantities that you need to purchase or to store or to have in your inventory. And also you need to think of the transportation network and how you can manage this network and the flow of products and spare parts and communication and information. And remember when we talked about cost leadership, we need to consider cash operating cycle. So this the cash operating cycle is the amount of time it takes for an organization to recover the cash it has paid out for the development, production, and distribution. And in your supply chain, you will have different partners. Customers, retailers, suppliers, distributors, transportation and logistics companies. And you need to think of these partners and how you have the best supply chain planning, operating and execution and evaluation approaches to support these partners. This week, we learned how the operation management is fitting into the big picture. We also talked about the responsibilities of operations managers. And we talked about the organization's value chain, including primary and secondary activities. We talked about process management and supply chain management. I hope you read the readings well and review all the concepts that we learned together this week. See you next week.